In this exercise, we would like to imagine that two cylinders are intersecting. I'll sketch the picture as best I can in just a moment. And one cylinder is basically cutting out what is sort of like a disc-shaped region from the other. In fact, two such regions on opposite sides of the cylinder. We want to compute the surface area of those two regions combined. Okay, so I said all that in words, but let me try to sketch a picture of what's going on. We have the cylinder x squared plus y squared equals capital R squared. So capital R is the radius of the cylinder. And then let me see if maybe I didn't do this quite right over here. I want to imagine that the cylinder x squared plus z squared equals R squared is intersecting that. So that's going to be like this. So let's see, kind of imagine that this cylinder, okay. All right, that looks kind of terrible, but hopefully it communicates the idea of the two cylinders intersecting. What we want to do is figure out the surface area of this region that I've sketched closest to me and add to that the same area on the opposite side. So if you picture these two cylinders intersecting, in fact, I'll put up a much better picture in just a moment in case this one doesn't really communicate what's happening. They're going to intersect in two separate regions, which enclose the same amount of surface area. So we will just do one computation and then double it. That's the first observation to make. We only need to compute one of the two cylindrical faces here, compute that area, and then double it. All right. In case you're struggling to picture this and my picture didn't help, let me step aside just for a moment and I will put up a computer-generated illustration of what this intersection looks like. Then we'll come back and start to set up the problem. Okay. I'm going to try to make this picture a little bit better. Both of these cylinders have radius capital R. And I'm imagining that this orange cylinder, the cylinder x squared plus z squared equals capital R squared, is hitting this cylinder x squared plus y squared equals R squared from the side. So let me add some axes to this so that we can really see the shape emerge. This cylinder is symmetric about the z-axis. So you can imagine that there's the z-axis. This cylinder is symmetric about the y-axis. So actually the axis I'm going to imagine coming out of this cylinder is the y-axis. Whenever you sketch your axes for three-dimensional space, you want to make sure that they satisfy the right-hand rule. So in particular, x would have to come, say, this way. Sketch it kind of like that. So that I cross j is k. Okay, so this is the picture I've sketched to be appropriate with the right-hand rule. Let's parametrize this surface space that I've highlighted here. We need a parametrization of the form R of U and V to stick with traditional notation. So I will parametrize this surface with these two parameters, but if you want to call them something a little bit more specific, like theta and Z, ultimately, that's fine too. That's just a choice of letter for your parametrization. Okay. The way to do this is to start by looking at this cylinder. Recognize that the face here, whose area we are trying to compute, lives on the side of the cylinder. So every point in this region here satisfies the equation x squared plus r squared equals capital R squared. I said that wrong a moment ago. X squared plus y squared equals capital R squared. The xy coordinates of any point which satisfies this equation can be written as r cosine u and r sine u. So the idea here is r cosine u squared plus r sine of u squared equals r squared cosine squared plus r squared sine squared, which is r squared. So whenever you see that, you want to proceed to this kind of parameterization. Then I have one of the two parameters that I'm looking for. So anytime you parameterize a surface, you want to have two parameters. You want and you need this. So here's one giving me my angle where I am in this region. So it's angle relative to the xy plane. It's taking me around this region. And then what keeps me in here inside this kind of bent disk and not way up here or down here is the z coordinate. So the fact that x is going to satisfy this description and y this one places me on this cylinder, but that's not specific enough. I want to be here. I'm going to write z, or I was going to, but actually I'm going to call that v. Again, you're welcome to just call it z. You don't always have to name your parameters u and v, but I'm going to do that here. Where, to place us in this region, I'm now going to give you really specific bounds on u and v. Because right now, this parametric description just says x and y live on the cylinder of radius capital R, x squared plus y squared equals capital R squared. And the z coordinate is something. That could be any point on the cylinder. Okay, so there are two things we need to do with our bounds for the parameters here. One is I need to control z so that we're not up here, down here, we're here. And then also with my angle u here, I want to place this in this space. So let me do that one first, actually. Notice, it might be hard to see with my picture, but if you have this mentally in mind, you might have a good sense of this. My picture's not too bad at this point, but I'll also put up a graphic where you can really see this in just a moment. This region, it's bending around the cylinder, and it actually touches in a tangential way its mirror image on the other side. So it's like we have two kind of bending disc-shaped regions, and where they meet, you know, the edges of each of these regions is on the x-axis. So if I wanted to rotate by angle theta all the way around in such a way to cover this disc, I would go from 0 to pi over 2 to pi. So the angle theta for this side of the cylinder is from 0 to pi. That's my u parameter. So let me write about here. 0 is less than or equal to u. I almost started to write theta. Maybe I should call these parameters theta and z, but we'll stick with u and v. Okay. To reiterate, this gives you half of the cylinder. It gives you this half, the half that I've kind of sketched closest to me. If I let u go from pi to 2 pi, I would be on the back half of the cylinder, the part that's farther away from me, and that's where the other region is. And then 0 to 2 pi would just be one full revolution around the cylinder. So if I want to focus on just this one face, this would be the correct domain for the angle of rotation. Then what about v, telling us our z height? For that, I just want to ensure that my z coordinate lives between these two arcs. So this lower arc down here is going to give me my lower bound for v, and this arc up here gives me my upper bound for v. Imagine that I took that y-axis and pointed it right at my eye so that I didn't really see the y-coordinate. I would be looking really at just the x-z plane. Then we would be looking at a circle in the x-z plane, the circle of radius capital R. So that means that this lower semicircle in that plane would be z equals negative square root of r squared minus x squared. And this one is z equals the square root of r squared minus x squared. Those define the bounds for the parameter v. All I need to do is take x and use my description for it. So I'm trying to think if I want to just write the final answer or work it out first. I'll work it out first. Okay, so let me say, what is r squared minus x squared? If I know that x is r cosine u, well, this is going to be the square root of r squared minus r squared cosine squared, the angle u. And then notice The r squared, they have in common here, so let me factor that out. R squared 1 minus cosine squared. This is a perfect square. Capital R is a positive number. It's the radius. So let me pull that out front. And then 1 minus cosine squared is sine squared from the Pythagorean identity. Like so. Here's one reason why I wanted to just focus on one region at a time, and that is that if u is between 0 and pi, sine is non-negative. So it's when u is 0, sine of u is 0, and then again at pi it's 0, and then between the two it's positive. So I can just go ahead and square root this. So that this simplifies pretty nicely into lower bounds that look like negative r sine of u and r sine of u. Okay, just barely squeeze that in there. Let me pause for a moment in case you would like to think a little bit more through this computation. I will put up the graphic, the computer-generated graphic of these two cylinders again, hoping that you can really see in particular the angle u and how it needs to go from 0 to pi to cover one of the two faces. Now we're ready to set up and evaluate the double integral that gives us the surface area of our region. To do that, I first need to take this parameterization and compute the vectors of partial derivatives with respect to u and with respect to v. So what I call r sub u will be negative r sine of u, r cosine of u, 0, and then r sub v will be 0, 0, 1. I space it out like this because I'm about to do a cross product, and I think a cross product is easier when the coordinates are lined up. Here, because of the zeros in the second vector, it's not too bad. But if I'm going to cross the first one, I get r cosine of u. For the second one, I get, I'm surprised it's zero. It's not zero. It's r sine of u. It should look like the first coordinate and then zero. Okay. For a surface area integral, what we want to integrate is the magnitude of this vector. The magnitude of that is r. That's something that you can do pretty quickly. Because r cosine squared plus r sine squared is r squared, so you'd be doing the square root of r squared and you get r. So that's the length of this vector. I think I can actually go ahead and finish this in the space that's remaining to me. So the surface area. Because I'm looking to actually do both faces, let me start with the leading two. So the idea here is that we are going to double one of the two faces because they have the same shape. So two times one of the faces, if I call this face S, then it's 1ds. That is the conceptual form of the surface area computation. But then how do you evaluate that? Well, you use your parameterization and you say, I don't know if I'm going to fit this actually. We're going to integrate from 0 to pi from negative r sine of u to r sine of u. The integrand becomes the length of that cross product that we did. So that's just the constant r dv du. Okay. Let me pause here in case you're thinking through any of these steps. And this r here is a constant, so it can come in front. See if you can actually just go ahead and get to the end answer. Let's see if we got the same answer. I'll pull the r in front so that we have 2r. We're left with anti-differentiating 1 with respect to v. That gives us v. Plug in top bound, subtract off plugging in the bottom bound, and you're left with 2r sine of u. This is also pretty nice. So I'll pull the 2r in front, giving us 4r squared. the antiderivative of sine of u is negative cosine of u. Since that's not too bad, let me go ahead and plug in the top and bottom bounds. So we'll have negative cosine of pi minus negative cosine of 0. Okay, so that's negative negative 1 is positive 1 plus 1. So overall, this is 2. Then we have 8r squared total. Okay, so 8r squared. Each individual face is 4r squared, but again, I doubled it to get the full surface area enclosed by the intersection of these two cylinders. So one that I drew kind of facing me and one which is hidden in this picture on the back. The most interesting thing about this problem, in my opinion, is recognizing how to describe this region with two parameters. And in particular, I think where I would expect students to hesitate the most is in this third coordinate here, realizing that I don't really need something specific here. I'm just going to call it V. It just represents the height here. That's kind of independent of the X and Y coordinates. It's just whatever it is. But then how do I bound V so that I land right here? For that, I'm going to use the other cylinder equation to get the lower and upper bounds. And that pair of bounds is ultimately what shapes this intersection on the side of the cylinder. Okay, I hope that was illuminating for you. Thank you for your attention.